Today on Life Signatures Wednesday's Conversations, I am having a conversation with Vincent Kalema, or the way he likes to call himself, Kalema Vincent. He is the CEO and founder of an organization called Vikale. Of course, you can guess that is from his name. Vikale is an organization that is focused on increasing returns on investments in farming through mechanization. He is helping farmers in commercial farming business to increase their returns on investments, to make sure that they are maximizing their time and their resources in poultry farming. He is a very young man, and how he got into this business is a story you really want to listen to. He's also the founder of Eggman, an organization that is having a focus of reducing the time frame between the farm and the fork as far as the egg is concerned. You want to listen to this?
Welcome to the Life Signatures Podcast with Lawrence Namale. Lawrence is a life coach, author, and keynote speaker who loves to tackle different topics on purpose, productivity, and resilience. His mission in life is to awaken all your boundless possibilities available in you. Life Signatures Podcast is dedicated to bring to reality every single person who knows that deep down in their gut, there's got to be more to life than this. And now, here is your host, Lawrence Namale.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everybody who is tuned into this podcast today. I hope you're doing well. I hope you have had a good time. So far, so good this year. This is the first quarter of the year. It's coming to an end. And today in the episode on this Wednesday's conversation, I have an opportunity to talk to a crazy guy. Are you crazy? Because the things that you're doing, it's one of a kind, isn't it?
Yeah, sure.
What you're doing is one of a kind. As in, you have not copied and pasted this from someone else.
No, not at all. Yeah.
This is one of a kind that is in Kampala so far.
Yeah.
We don't know of anyone who is doing this.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we're going to talk about that. And of course, I've already introduced him to you guys. I've told you about his profile and so on. So, Vikale.
Yes.
That's your name, or that's the name of the organization?
Yes, that's the name of the organization. That's the name of the company. Yes.
It comes from your name.
Vincent Kalema, yes.
Vincent Kalema. Does Kalema have a meaning?
I haven't taken time to find out deeply, but
yeah.
It's a Ugandan name from the royal clan.
You're a royal?
Yes. Omulangira.
Do you know Eve Zaluangu?
Yes, I know.
Are you guys related?
No.
But she's also royalty.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I interviewed her. I think you've seen her episode last week.
Interesting one, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you don't know what the name means, but it means you also come from royalty.
Correct.
In the Buganda Kingdom. Do people treat you specially? You know, people so sure.
What is interesting is that we're growing up, we're always reminded that.
Yeah.
Royalty is from your pockets.
Yeah.
Do not think that you're special than everybody else.
Okay.
What will make you special is exactly how much comes out of your pocket.
Mm.
That's what will make you a loyal.
Which means you add value to yourself.
Correct.
Other than depending on the title
of
the royal clan.
Exactly, yes.
Wow, that's interesting.
Exactly, yes.
Okay, so you're not like raised with kid gloves, you know, pamper you and so on.
No, not really. I was I was fortunate and unfortunate. Mm. The last of the six children, was the last born.
Mm.
I was, when I was born,
yeah,
I don't know what I can say. Okay, I'm the last born, but when my parents died when I was young.
Oh.
As the last one, so.
Yeah.
It gave me a great opportunity to get into life.
Mm.
Because my father was a banker.
Mm-hmm.
He worked with the BOU.
Mm.
And he pretty much had a good job. I mean, this is what I hear from my older siblings, what they say. And life wasn't really bad.
Yeah.
Growing up in a government house.
Yeah.
And he had one job all his life.
Yeah.
BOU, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, life wasn't really bad.
Mm.
Yeah, and I think they died when I was five.
Both of them?
Yeah. Whoa. Possibly within the same year.
Yeah.
Or a year apart. 95 and 96. Yeah,
yeah.
So me starting out primary, they already died. I primary, I think 1997.
Yeah.
1998.
Uh-huh.
When they died, there was really no support because my siblings also were young. We were still in school at the same time. So.
Yeah.
I ended up going to stay with my grandmother.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I was with her for the whole of primary, primary 7.
And the other siblings?
Yeah, what is interesting is that my other siblings were in Kampala.
Yeah.
And the grandmother was staying in Masaka, so.
Yeah.
I actually was staying with her.
So the other siblings were with other relatives? Or
no, they were alone.
They were alone.
Yeah.
They were old enough to take care of themselves.
Well, there was no option.
Mm.
There was no option, really, because nobody could take them on and all that. Yeah. But
so they started fending for themselves?
Correct, yes.
Okay.
Correct, yes.
So now you being the youngest, someone else has to, you know, take
but
you under.
Yeah. I mean, she was also, she's still alive.
Yeah.
Very interesting. She's with us near home here.
Yeah.
Now in Kampala.
Yeah.
Yeah, but even when I was with her, they really wanted me to be with them.
And
said, I think you need to come and be with us. We need to know where my brother is. We need to be able to, you don't know what's happening. Because if you have a kid, your kid brother in the village, you don't know what's happening with him. But so after when I finished P7, is when I joined them in Kampala.
Mm.
Yeah, but that was...
You passed your examinations?
Yeah,
because
I certainly did. I was one of the bright kids.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe they're very good, or it's throughout primary.
Yeah,
one or two. So
yeah,
I certainly by standards I did well.
Okay, so by the potential well. Was there.
Yeah, but also what was interesting, but I think the detail I left out was there was a young brother.
Mm.
To my father, he's the one who was paying my fees by then when I was staying with the grandmother
in
the village. Yes, the uncle actually. So he was the one who was paying for me during that period of time. So, I mean, also financially, I think wasn't doing well when I finished P7. So then I started to figure out exactly how do I get in. I had to sit for about two terms before joining S1.
Whoa.
And I think I did one term. S1.
Yeah, and then
nearby village school.
Yeah.
And then after that, I went to, I had to go to another school.
In S1 also?
S2, I think second term.
Hey, you guy, how do you do that? I mean, that's a genius, so to speak. You've done S1 just one term.
One term.
And then you go to S2 the second term.
Then I did S2 the second term in another school around Masaka.
You were not struggling academically?
Sorry?
Were you struggling academically?
No, not academically. I think everything was around finance.
Right.
Really, finance, because you have an old lady that doesn't have any source of income, and you have an uncle who was taking care, and now also he's not doing well because of the other responsibility that actually he has.
Mm.
So... the good thing is that I was involved primarily. Throughout my primary, I was involved in co-cultural activity, dancing, you know, instruments.
Yes, MDD.
MDD. So I got an opportunity to go to the other school where I could be able to train, St. Charles Rwankasasa. I went in as a trainer for the instruments because this is a thing we wanted to do. So I went in to train them.
Mm.
I remember someone, my big brother, went there with me to. to speak with the ed teacher and say, this guy, if he can do this, maybe we can pay a bit of some money. We could raise some money. And then also during, you know, the holidays, we could just stay behind and
help
dig.
The kids, yeah.
No, and dig, because we have
the do some work at school.
Correct.
In order to pay the school fees.
The other half. So during the holidays, I would stay behind.
Yeah.
That was S2.
Where would you sleep?
The boarding
section, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I was actually in the boarding section because of the boarding school, yes.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I think the end of S2, the head teacher then was transferred.
I know what's coming. So the arrangement is spoiled.
Yeah, it's spoiled because then you cannot talk to anybody. This was a personal, you know.
Yeah.
I think this is something he did out of... Yeah. Personally, I don't know whether he was also contributing money out of his pocket. This I can't tell, to be honest with you. But this was the arrangement that we made. So then we had to, at that time, we had to figure out. My brother had to figure out, what do we do now? So we had to come to get a school in Kampala, Kololo SS.
So this Kololo SS that's...
puts on white.
Where is it? It's near Watoto?
No, the one at Lugogo Bypass.
Oh, the one at Lugogo Bypass. The one you guys dress white.
Yes.
I've always wondered. That school has white uniform, as in trousers are white.
Correct.
Shirts are white.
Yeah.
How do they manage anyway?
Easy to manage. I was once awarded for being the smartest there.
Really?
Cleanest, yes.
With white?
With white, yes.
Okay.
Possibly. I love white. I think maybe one of my spirits must have been picked up from there.
Yeah. You're also dressed in white, and that's one of the company colors.
Yeah, I choose. I don't know, white for me is a sign of purity.
Yeah.
I would say, because if you have white and you stain it, anyone can see it from anywhere.
Yeah.
For me, it is a reminder on how you should work in business should be as pure as it is. If anything stains it,
it can affect it negatively.
Correct.
Okay, so Kololo SS all the way up to
S4. So Kololo SS, interesting, when I just got it there, I don't know whether it was the second time again, but I don't know when elections I don't remember what used to happen when in secondary school. When do they normally hold elections for prefects? Is it second term or first term? I don't know. But for some reason, what I remember is that the first week I got there, they were calling for nominations for prefect.
Don't tell me you went.
Yeah, of course I did. And I went in for the highest office.
Yes.
At that level, that is being the deputy prefect. Yeah, and I won.
What?
Yes, I won. I became the deputy.
That's like serious confidence right there.
Correct.
You did not get affected, you know, by coming from a quote unquote poor family, and you did not feel like.
Yeah, but also you must understand that what some of my confidence was from a fact that thinking. So if you come from, because I was supposed to be working from home. Up to school, and I'm the youngest, but everybody at home gets up, walks, goes wherever they can, look for a job. Everyone was actually hustling in their own way, so nobody's there to prepare lunch and all. I was the youngest, so I would be able to prepare anyway for everybody else. So the point is that, how do I access a meal a day? It is a very good question. How do you access a meal if you're at school? The surest way not to miss a meal,
become a leader. So it was probably nothing to do with confidence, but a lot to do with am I gonna eat or what? Survival for the fittest.
Yeah, and a good meal.
Yeah,
you know, a good meal. So give a bit of assurance. But of course, that said, there are gaps that I saw that maybe I could, you know, fill up.
But let me ask you: once you got there, did you realize that you were meant for this? You were a good leader.
That's yes. Correct,
The leadership came out.
Yes.
Okay. Good.
Yes. I mean, primary was also, you know, class monitor. But these are things you never pay attention to.
Yeah.
You really never pay attention to this. Some of these things, really. To be honest with you.
Okay. So Kololo SS, you're the deputy head prefect.
Yes.
Getting S3? Nice food.
S4, yes.
Up to S3, up to S4.
Correct.
And then did you do S6?
I said I should look for better, you know, I need to challenge myself better, because I thought maybe I've been there long. I don't know, maybe because I've been At that point, I'd been in so many schools
where
I was just doing a term or two.
Yeah.
But I felt that I needed a new challenge. Mm. I needed to go maybe something better. So I applied to go to Chitante. Because I was looking again for a day school. I mean, there's no way we would really afford boarding school anywhere.
Yeah.
So the easiest thing was to, first of all, so getting used to the life.
Yeah.
Because if you're in there, you are in life.
Yeah.
The hustle.
Yeah.
Nothing comes free and all that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I got in Chitante as well.
Okay.
So I got into Chitante and
Mm.
Also, when I got there, elections came in. I said, I need to go for the highest office here. Yeah, so I went for the highest office.
Mm-hmm.
And I won, yes.
Wow.
Correct. I said, very good now. The mills are very, I'm sure
that
I can.
That is sorted.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is sorted. Of course, there are a lot of, you know, changes that we had to be made and all that.
Mm.
But yeah, we did well.
Mm.
We certainly did well, yes.
You passed your examinations, A6?
Yes, I passed my examinations, yes. And also the life there was that the agreement at the time, because, I mean, it's a level you are mature enough.
Yeah.
Is where my siblings told me, you know what, I think there's what we can contribute, and maybe also what you can, if you, there's what we can do. You cannot expect that we shall give you, I mean,
everything.
It's a, you can walk up to school.
Yeah.
There are things that you should find for yourself.
Yeah.
We can do our best to contribute.
Yeah.
You know.
But that's a very tight-knit family.
Yeah.
It paints the picture that you guys were really together. You really watched each other's backs.
Yes, together, but also the idea of empowering you.
Yeah.
At that time, I could go to any office and tell them and say, guys, because so many times I used to go to the bus and tell him, Papa, to be honest with you, even if you send me home, there's no money.
Yeah.
So what is wise is let me study.
Yeah.
Please do not send me away.
Uh-huh.
And I think during
so you learned negotiation at an early age.
At an early age.
Yeah.
I would, I think right from S2, they would encourage me.
Mm.
If my brother is not, I say, no, you go and talk to.
They will not accompany you to school. They say you handle it yourself.
Talk to him.
Yeah.
Explain yourself.
Mm.
Tell him the situation. Tell him, there's no money now.
Mm.
It is unfortunate that you would want to send me back home.
Mm.
Because if you send me back home,
I'll just go and sit there and do nothing.
I won't even have lunch. So better I stay here. And I studied.
Yeah.
You know, because for sure, when I get the money, I'll certainly for sure. And, you know, sometimes the boss will tell me, say, hey, boss, you need to be a good example.
Yeah.
Now, how do we? You are the head prefect.
How do we send
you now?
Yeah. But, you know, it worked also to your advantage being the head prefect.
Yeah, those are one of the reasons I'd already figured out before I got into the office.
Oh, you thought ahead of
time.
Yes,
I thought because it would be, I would have a cordial relationship with these people because I would be easily talk to the teacher and explain to them.
Yeah.
You know, and say this is the situation and say, okay,
right.
Let's give you some time.
Right.
You know?
Wow. So it worked for you in such a way that, you know, they cannot send you home because you are an example. You're an example. You're the head prefect.
Correct.
How will you send the
head
prefect?
Even when the bus would come to the class to read names.
Can't read yours.
Yeah, he would skip you.
Yeah.
Then he called me and said, listen.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Hey, you guy. You know, what is going on in my mind right now is, you know, if we just even go on a tangent for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Such situations are very many in the country where there are very many bright kids, you know, who could actually study and make a name for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But they are being sent home because of school fees and because of this and that.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever thought as an organization maybe to start a fund for them, maybe support one or support two later on in life? You know?
Yeah, certainly.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yes. Yeah, it's something that I've always advocated for, that if there is an opportunity to help someone.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I've always dreamt to do it incognito, as in you walk into a school.
Thank you. Yes.
You go to the bursar,
say,
show me a list of kids who are really struggling.
Mm-hmm.
And you just settle the bill. Don't tell anyone.
Correct.
And you walk away.
Correct.
You know, just let them be let it be known that they're an angel, so to speak, has paid their fees.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, a kid of that particular nature will go and really study.
That's true.
When the kid realizes that I don't have any fees arrears, someone has paid for me,
and
I don't know even who that is. They feel like they owe it to the world to show cause, you know, true. To study.
Yeah, but also something that I learned from my story with my older siblings and their sacrifice for me is that life skills. They indirectly taught me a lot of life skills. That helped me, gave me a very good head start. Because
it's like what I normally call being street smart.
Yeah.
You became street smart when you were still at school.
Correct.
So even when you finish school and so on, you're not asking yourself what next. You already have been figuring out things for yourself.
Yeah. I've always been older than my age.
Yeah.
You know, it gets to the point where you get to...
You grow up. When you're a kid, you just grow up as a kid. Yeah.
Yes. And also when we left high school, I think I had a year in between. Of course, we had some issues of finance as well, but I'd applied to MOOBs because one of the things also that one of my brothers helped me out is to figure out around this four, which direction do I need to take? You know, what do I need to concentrate on? I said, you seem to be good with the arts. Don't waste a lot of your time.
On sciences. Yeah.
You know, so concentrate. Oliver told me, boss, improve your math. Improve your English. These are very important for you to get anything you need at a six. End up really doing an arts course. And you also told me, you know, so I did well with A-level. When I went to A-level, I did well. And I knew what I wanted, what I applied for. I applied for business administration.
That was which you got?
MOOBs. Yes.
Okay.
Which I got. And also I knew from A-level or whatever that I had to apply for an evening course. Evening class. Because then I had to look for
because money. During the day you have to fend for yourself.
Yes, I have to look for the money.
Yeah.
To pay the tuition.
To pay for the tuition.
Yeah. One of my brothers told me, yes. I mean, I cannot offer to pay your school fees. Tuition.
Who for that?
One of my brothers told me, I cannot offer
to
pay.
Yeah.
What I can offer is one thing.
Yeah.
If you ever feel you're on the wall, come to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
If all fails.
Yeah.
Come to me when you have not paid nothing.
Start something.
Correct.
Take charge of your life.
Thank you.
And in case your back hits the wall,
I've got your back.
Whoa. Yeah. Awesome.
I would understand maybe you have a week to examination and you then I know you failed. Don't come to me at the beginning of the semester and say I need money. No, you have not failed. You have not done nothing about it.
So you are there. And he says, "I got your back."
Yes.
In case you have an issue,
correct.
Your back has hit against the wall.
Yeah.
You come to me.
Yeah.
What did that do to you?
Well, the life skill to basically understand that you have to take on life.
Yeah.
You have to be in charge.
Yeah.
You have to be responsible for your life.
Yeah.
And also to understand that, I mean, yes. To put life into perspective, we're born together, yes, true, but you have to be thankful that I can help.
Yeah.
It's not my responsibility.
Yeah.
Which I think is a very good thing.
Yeah.
It gives you a very good perspective as a young man to take charge.
So you enroll at MOOBs, evening classes.
Evening classes.
During the day you're hustling.
Yeah.
Looking for fees.
Yeah.
And that's how you did all the way until you finished.
Yes.
Yes. Nobody else chipped in to pay for your school fees?
No, I mean, my siblings.
Yeah.
Basically, my brother was very helpful.
Yeah.
During those times.
Yeah. So you finish MOOBs?
Yes.
Was it like a relief?
Yes. I don't know. I don't know what to feel, but... As already, for me, it didn't change anything.
Yeah.
As far as my life was concerned, because...
Because you're already fending for yourself.
I was already in the field.
Yes.
I was already working.
Yes.
I'd got a job with a German company. And I was the sales representative for Uganda. And that's how I got into poultry, by the way.
What were you selling?
Poultry equipment.
Now, let me ask you a question.
Of course, I skipped quite a lot in between because in our hustle, as I told you, as we had learned to hustle, during that period, with my friend, we were getting in there and say, we are looking for anything. We want to be anywhere.
We
do not care.
We
do proposals and say, we think we can do something like this.
Yeah.
So
you basically what you were taking on the world.
Yes.
Taking the world on and
so
on.
So as much as I was doing even in class, I can call myself a ghost student.
But you know, one of the things that was going on for you, I think you were sharp upstairs. You are an intelligent by nature, intelligent student by nature.
And also my brother told me, boss, I'm ahead of you. I know what life is.
Yeah.
Concentrate on getting a second class upper.
Wow.
Hmm.
That did something to you, isn't it? Having a mentor, your brother was basically a mentor, isn't it?
Correct, yes.
Who was basically shining the light.
Yes.
Even when where he had not reached, had he reached uni himself?
No, he was already working.
He was already working. Yeah, he had gone through uni.
Yeah, yeah. So he knew this. All my siblings are almost graduated.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now they know what steps you're supposed to take, and they're just like guiding you and leading you.
Correct. For me, telling me what is the most important thing.
Mm.
Because sometimes you get consumed in a lot of noise.
So you don't waste time on unnecessary ventures.
Correct.
Yeah.
I remember a lot of times I missed tests at university.
Yeah.
Like weekend tests, what they do, but I would come either before I would travel.
Yeah.
I remember all the 3 years I was at university, I traveled all over the country.
Yeah.
Doing an NGO work.
Yeah.
As part timing and volunteering there. But it also helped me quite a lot because I was working there.
So, one of the things that you can gain there is to realize that when you are working, so to speak, even if you're not being paid, payment comes in different forms.
That's
there is the exposure.
Exposure.
Right? Yeah, there is the experience.
Yes.
There is the opening you to meet other people that you've never met before.
But also what is interesting for me, also to take away, is that I didn't really have so much of an option, per se, or a privilege to not do it. Because I didn't even care. Even if I was to a place where they were giving me lunch, I would be okay with it. I would walk there, you know, and make my contribution and I go back and I'm happy. Than being home and you're hungry and everyone has gone wherever they're going and nothing is happening. So we got a point where I said, you know what? So particularly there was a TV station that we landed on. It was in Kawempe.
Yeah.
They were doing certain things, but we went there with the phenomenon and told them, you know what? It was owned by a pastor. We told them, guys, there's a revamp we can do with this station. You're sitting on gold.
And you've never done anything on radio.
No, we had never done anything like that. It was a TV station. So, you know, I think you can change the graphics. My friend was very good.
By
standards, because he was also at university. I was also at university as well. He's a very good, he was a friend of mine that, he's a friend of mine that we came with from school.
Yeah.
Of course, school, I also told you that we had also formed clubs that I didn't mention about A-level with a friend of mine.
Yeah.
Where we're meeting and discussing things.
Yeah.
A lot of things I left out that could be very interesting for you. But yes, went to the station, told these guys we can change a lot of things. Graphics needs to be better. We think we can do sales. As I said, I can do sales on this side, on this side of the story. So, that's how we started, me pushing out and looking for clients. So and what happened is that opportunities find you on the move. The German company phoned me.
You see, that's one statement that you cannot just let to pass. Opportunities find you on the move. Because the normal education, and I'm going to ask you a question about that later on, but the normal education is structured in this way, that you finish school. Meanwhile, all along you've been in school, you've not been in life, you've not been in the streets like you were, but you are in school, academic, pure academics, you know, 411 pure academics. Then when you finish, then that's when you start looking for an opportunity. For you, you are already in the streets, and so opportunities find you when you are already there.
Yes.
And now these opportunities, they're not necessarily even looking for what is your academic qualification? Mm-hmm. Did they even ask you those that stuff?
No. I think for me, coming from a background where I come from, I realized that if you're already disadvantaged, you need to work twice as hard to level up.
Yeah.
You need to be, you know, disciplined more. You need to work more.
Yeah.
You know,
there's a term they use it, and I used it in one of my videos. It's called they call that those guys a scrapper. Uh-huh. You become a scrapper. Yeah. You know, you're scrapping around, and it's the way you're going to make it.
Correct.
Otherwise, the other guys are already ahead of you. The ones who are already advantaged, they're already ahead of you. You cannot measure up to them with the same level that they're doing life. You can't do life that way.
You have to work twice as hard to get a half of what they have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's exactly what you did.
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask you this. Do you have kids?
No, not yet.
Would you, looking back in your education, would you regret anything?
Not at all.
You are okay, that's the way it went.
No, not at all. I don't think I would be the person I am.
Without that life.
I would not be thinking the same way. Because looking back, by using one example, when I was going to boarding school, I would on the reporting day, I would go with an empty suitcase. Only my clothes. I didn't have sugar, nothing, zero.
Yeah.
No way to get them.
Yeah.
I at no point did I ever feel bothered or unhappy or unfair. I was glad
that you were in school.
I was able to access a school where we used to sell jackfruit.
Ah.
You know, because during primary.
Yeah.
Also in primary, by the way, I didn't mention.
Yeah.
There's someone he's also now becoming a very successful businessman in Endeavor now.
Yeah.
He's a guy who used to sell jackfruit with. He's a man who gave me the first shoe that I put on in my life. I think it was around P6. So we would look for jackfruit all over on the village.
Yeah.
And after school,
we'd
we'd take it to that school. Because it was a very big, prominent school around.
Who would buy the
students? The kids would actually in turn. You know what they would give us? They never had the money, so they would give us books, they would give us pencils, they would
barter trade.
A few of the guys will give you money.
Yeah.
A few of the guys will give you money.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you end up getting a book. Sometimes you sell them. Sometimes you use them in.
Yeah.
So you take them to the shops and sell them at a discounted price. Mm. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you learned selling as a kid. Now, so the question that I wanted to ask you is this.
Yeah.
Obviously, if you have kids,
yeah.
What kind of education do you expose them to? Do you think a bit of what you did will benefit them, or you'll be like one of these parents who say, I suffered, you know?
Yeah.
I suffered, my kids will never suffer.
I honestly don't know. Sometimes I think, of course, there is a compensation effect where you do not want your kids to go through what you've gone through.
Yeah.
I've not had them. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's hard to imagine how you treat them.
Mm.
But I would imagine that you need to expose them on a bit of life.
Yeah.
I learned that the thing that I went through outside school, or along school, impacted me more, even up to this date.
Mm.
You know, that even when I'm going through a hard situation, I don't really... Because I easily find no way to end, or it is temporary for me.
Mm.
I think that the biggest challenge would be to get more involved in your children's life. Involved more.
Other than just sending them to school and let the school system take care of them.
Yes.
Because what you are going to give them is what you got from the streets.
Yeah. But right? Also, I think that, okay, besides what is within class, one of the interesting things about the education here is, of course, it is meant indirectly to teach certain virtues, like greed, discipline, the idea that they give you a lot of things in your head and then you have to figure it out. You know, I'm not an educationist, so sometimes, of course, as an employer now, I feel that there is a very big gap.
Yeah, you've seen it in the people that you employ.
Correct.
You know, I've interviewed guys before, and it's one of the most traumatizing seasons of HR, trying to look for a resource that can fit what you want to be done, because you have the vision of how you want the company to run. Of course, if you have the vision of how you want the company to run, you have a profile of the kind of people that you want to employ. And so you find it a bit hard. You interview like 10 guys before you can land onto a guy that seems like this one can be able to work.
A lot of guys are good on paper.
Yeah.
So sometimes you seek out for attitude, you know, have these people been through some, because basically at work or life is problem solving every day.
Yeah,
so that you're looking for people who have a certain attitude, who have the skills.
Yeah.
At that point, you would think maybe having someone so qualified, maybe overrated, to be honest, because now you prefer to hire someone who can easily unlearn and learn than somebody who thinks they know what to do. Because sometimes you've learned something in school and don't really apply to working
at home.
There's a bit, generally there's a mismatch.
There's
a mismatch. So I don't know, how do we fill it up, or by what is easier? Do we as parents or parents getting more involved?
I think that's
Does the education system wait until it changes?
No, they are really trying as much as they can to change the education system. But let me tell you this, that the way your brother guided you, that is the way parents are supposed to guide their children. Because schooling or education is not just 100% academics. I had someone saying the other day that actually it's a doctor. Is it a doctor? Or, I can't remember. That 30% of what they got was... this is not a doctor. It's a guy who is in the startup world. They've done computer science and all that stuff. But they said that 30% of what they did in school is what is relevant to them. But even as they were in school, they were out there trying to build stuff with their lecturer, who was an American. So this the American will go out there and get some jobs and show these guys how to pitch, how to form a company, and so on. So he says that 70% is much more relevant than the academics of 30%. Doesn't mean that the 30% is useless. It's just that the 70% is needed. So in this day and in this age, if you're going to say you want to instill that into children, you're not going to do it with the school system, because they don't have the capacity. The teachers don't have, they're not even enough. And then secondly, the resources, they're not even enough. And then thirdly, the school system is generally focused on people getting a job after they graduate. You get. But there is so much that you can be able to do even if you're not looking for a job. And that is not in the mainstream education system. So you said it correctly earlier on, that I think it's a responsibility of us parents. We've got to be, yes, take them to school. Take the kids to school. Give them the best education that they can be able to get. But on a daily basis, you are involved in shaping them to become street smart.
So for example, I remember, for example, when I joined my brothers as the youngest.
Yeah.
And we had, I think, 2 units.
Yeah.
We were staying. We had 2 units for rent, because we had a very small house. So, they gave me responsibility to collect rent from these people, call them, receive the money, sit down, budget. So I received money from tenant A, buying beans, buying rice, buying this, buying flour that would take us for
X number of
another
days.
Month.
Yeah, that was your responsibility.
Yes, get the money. Yeah. The youngest. I mean, everyone would do it, but I said, let's give this guy responsibility.
These guys, they really. I mean, they really helped you.
So being very intentional.
Yeah.
As a young lad, maybe you may not realize how important this is.
Yeah.
Sometimes maybe a bother.
Yeah.
But the ability to receive this money, take responsibility, budget for it.
Yeah.
And, you know.
That's growing,
also
my friend.
Home management.
Yeah.
Home, prepare meals, do the washing and do all these things. So
basically be responsible and take charge.
Correct.
As a kid, you know, that's the education, really. That is also education. because you're already doing life. They normally say that education is supposed to prepare you for life, but I think you're supposed to do life even as you're getting education.
Correct.
That's the thing that we miss.
Correct, yeah.
So it tells me that by the time you're through with MOOBs, you are already on the go. You're already moving. You're not like...
I'm yet to speak my transcript, by the way.
Even as we speak right now. Like you did not have a... You did not hustle around looking for a graduation gown.
It almost didn't happen. And my brother said, man, you guy, we have to do something.
You were not bothered about that?
No, I was not really. I was happy that it's done. I looked at the result. I showed them. Let me tell you one thing.
Uh-huh.
That one of the biggest brothers will tell you, they had never ever bothered to go where I studied.
It was you doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, so nobody would bother. I mean, if you get a retake, it's your problem. It's none of our, it's your life, man.
Yeah.
So you have to figure out things. You have to be responsible for yourself.
Yeah.
So when it was done, I said, yes, this is good. But I mean, like, my life was going on.
Yeah.
That's why I wasn't really so much bothered about doing as a party or
anything like graduation gowns and so on.
Yeah. But they said, man, no, let's do something. This is what we're to celebrate. Yeah. Let's celebrate it. So we did a party, you know, and friends came around. I had a very good support group. One of the things I also realized as I was at university, the first thing I said, you know what, because I'm going to university, I'm doing evening, I need to identify the most serious group.
Hang around those ones.
So I was in the most serious discussion group in our year.
Yeah.
So all the tasks, all exercises, anything, the guys would, you know, say, listen, this was supposed to do, this one is done.
Yeah.
So that really helped me quite a lot. So I realized that's the only way. So I had a very good support group. So
your education was interesting. You know, I think what the education needs to be is like what you did, but minus the hustle, as in minus the unfortunate situation where you don't have school fees. But I think that's how education is supposed to be.
I don't know, man. I'm happy every day.
Yeah.
I am happy about my situation every day because...
So no one is asking you for the transcripts?
Nobody is.
Have you ever written a CV?
I think I have. Okay, yeah. This is what happened. This is my journey, how I joined the work life.
Yeah.
I was the HP, so we had a group of... Because we used to walk from home up to school. Mm. The school, what happens? You don't have to waste money to taxi and all. So we'd really walk in a group. So one of those days, I was around Kamocha, coming from Chitante, around Kamocha. We used to talk with my friends, discuss, and talk about a lot of things. So I think we were in a heated argument. This must have been a six, second term. In a heated argument with some of my friends. And we actually, around where the market takes place. So we were there arguing. I think this gentleman was just not so far away from us. I think he was listening. So we talked and talked and talked. After we walked off, he called me and said, young man, how are you? I said, I'm okay. He said, the quality of your debate and your thoughts, I like them. Which class? I said, the six. I said, okay, no problem. This is my business card. Call me when you finish your exams. I kept it. I held on to it. A few days after we had completed UACE, I think the guys were going for party and all. I called the guy.
Yeah.
He said, hey, you come to the office. His office was around Kanjocha. I think Kanjocha Street.
Yeah.
Near Independence.
Yeah, I know it.
Kanjocha House. I went there. I said, yeah, sure. Welcome and all this stuff. He said, oh, yeah, we... He told his colleagues, I said, this young man has something with him that is special. I met him and I gave him, I told him the story. I told him, okay, welcome. The job we have here is sales. We have a sales job. I said, yes, I'm more than happy to do this. Yeah, I said, yeah, you can start immediately selling space in a magazine. It was a new magazine.
What was the name of the magazine?
Business Today.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah. They gave me the job and they were giving me 15,000 a week. That included lunch and transport and airtime. I was really happy. I was happy to do that. Well, that's one of the things also I'm extremely very happy about. I walked all over Kampala.
Yeah. knocked on people's doors.
For advertising. And it's a new magazine. Guys said no.
Yeah.
Some of the guys said, boss, we can't advertise for the new magazine. Mm. Maybe if it's 2 years.
Mm.
But then I said, it's okay. We also have some hard copies you can buy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I remember this lady at Serena. She was a sales manager there. I used to go there every other day. She says, you come back tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Come back at 7, I'll be there. Come back at 8, I'll be there.
Mm-hmm.
One day she said, Vincent, you know what you're going to do?
Yeah.
What I'm going to do, because by our policy at Serena Hotels, we cannot take on advertising this new.
Mm.
I said, no, it's okay. We are happy to take on your advert.
Yeah.
Even if you do not pay because it's a magazine.
Yeah.
Maybe in turn you can buy from us copies.
Yeah.
Said, yeah, that's a good idea. We could. So she started actually buying copies of the magazines. I think every month, every issue.
Yeah.
Because you some come out once a month. So she would buy, I think, maybe, I don't know, 200 copies every month. So I would pick them and take them to Serena every month.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hey, you guys.
So that was how I got into. So immediately after exams, I went to this guy, started, you know, doing sales. And for that reason, I think I lost. I really took time to go and pick my admission forms.
Yeah.
And I think at some point you sort of feel like you don't need to go back.
Yeah.
I got a bit of setback at that time where I feel like you're struggling so much, it was expensive to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, but after I must be listening to the man, the boss, be serious.
Yeah.
You pick this thing.
Yeah.
So I went and picked admission the following year because this was basically like a dead year. And I started. And at that also is when I got the opportunity, my sister connected me to one of the NGOs. So I used to volunteer there as I work in the other magazine. Work in the other magazine, sometimes they call me for volunteering. So during those 3 years, I used to travel all over doing, as trained as a train of trainees, because it was a girls, designing with girls, paying some school fees for them, girls, so following them up and also training them, coordinating activities, problems that are affecting girls and all that. Yeah, so most of the time I'll be called upon to do the trainings, to go for monitoring. What I was determined about was really only if I had exams, but with tests, I would send people to go. Yeah, so that's how I entered into the work life. So even when we finished school, I was already settled in, because at that time, when I was in business today, you know, we, with my friend, is when we went into the station, the one I told you earlier. We gave them proposals, and then we got in there. We held interviews. We tried to change. We brought a lot of guys that are good on
the mic.
We come up with new programs
for
the station, but also to work on the, what they call it, the graphics as well.
Yeah.
That is where I met one of the clients that I was chasing for TV advert. He identified me. He said, but you man, I think you can sell these things the way you're
selling this advert thing. You can sell
every
for
day
us.
You are here. So he introduced me to this opponent. He said, well, look, this is it. Can you do it? I said, yeah, of course.
At what level, what entry level are they giving you this job?
Sales, really.
Sales representative.
Yeah, he at that level was just sell. Go look for farmers. That was really the job at that time. Just look for farmers.
And you're excited to take it on?
I was very, very excited. Every opportunity I was really, very excited. Because you see where we were in the TV. We were there. And we're not getting any money. You know. We had a guy there who would sometimes give you some transport to go back home, but also all the way home. Sometimes give you some money. My friend had a car. We used to call it a beast. So sometimes you give us money for the beast and then we drive back and all that. But which was a DMC most of the time. Sometimes it was walk and all that. But that's how the opportunity for came in. You know, but also his original idea was that he wanted to call farmers to a training and put them
put them together.
But also he's a very busy man.
Yeah.
Right now I think he's the ambassador somewhere in one of the UAE countries. So he was extremely very busy.
He's a Ugandan.
Yeah, he's a Ugandan, yes.
Okay. So he has this farm that is selling what was that?
One of the he's in business, but one of the because one of the his friends, mm. as your business, brought him an opportunity
mm.
that this company from German mm. wants to enter into this market because mm. they see it's the next thing
mm.
and they would want to modernize.
Mm.
They're selling modernizing equipment mm. for mm. agriculture.
Mm.
Yeah, so he came and took me to his office and sat me down and gave me some pliers and said, can mm. you sell this? I said, what are these?
Yeah.
I need to be explained what they are and then I can sell.
Just
what
tell me what these are.
Yeah.
Selling is my second name.
Yeah. What do these do? Eh?
Yeah.
I said, this and this. But for him to give me a contract or for him to facilitate me, because asking him, just facilitate me, I can go anywhere.
Yeah.
He was extremely very busy man.
Yeah.
He was working, he had a job
in
internal affairs, he had a lot of companies running, so he was extremely very busy to access.
Yeah.
So every time you're calling him, he said, no, we're going to start, don't worry, we're going to start. And,
mm.
and you know, time passed by, and
mm.
yeah, something wasn't really happening.
You mm.
know? Yeah, so. But ultimately, the guys came around,
mm.
and we used to meet every time the guys are coming into the country, he would call me and mm. say, listen, come and take these guys around.
Mm.
This guy, he was a Swiss man. You would take him around, check mm. the farms, give me the contacts and say, go here, go mm. there, go here, go there.
Mm.
You know, so until this guy asked me, but you man,
mm.
where are the cells? Because
mm. he
said, well, I told him it's cells.
Mm.
Because we are yet to start. He said, we need to sell.
Mm.
you know.
Mm.
So the guy asks me, what is the problem? I said, we just need to be facilitated. He said, don't do it.
He
said, shh. Me, I'll be facilitating you per month and you sell.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's how you started.
You can, you know, sell us $1 million and all that.
Yeah.
We are good to go. There's no pressure for us. Yeah.
Yeah.
So he
put did you put on some terms of your work, like commission and stuff like that?
No, they just offered me. They just offered and said, this is what we're giving you. This way. I said, yes, no problem.
You didn't even negotiate.
Yeah, negotiate what when I was not even earning any money. I need to pay tuition.
Yeah.
I need to do all these things.
So, yeah.
You know, anything that comes across my first, I think I can make money out of to be able to pay some tuition.
Yeah.
It's very good.
Yeah.
And also to afford me.
Yeah.
Anything.
So you started.
Yeah. So
sales started coming in?
Yeah. They started coming in.
Uh-huh.
They started coming in, yes.
And
the problem, I did some work there for about for some good time.
Yeah.
Really.
Like how long?
For some good time. It must have been 3 or 4 years.
Mm.
It must have been up to about 2017, I think. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Earning good money?
Not be able to survive.
Mm.
Really.
Just
being able to pay rent.
Enough to.
Yeah, pay rent, because now at the time that, you know, was moved out and we had to rent to the friend of mine. So
yeah.
We could afford to pay rent at least.
Yeah.
You bring half, I bring half.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. So, Vikale gets born,
yes,
in 2017.
Yeah, when I left the other side.
You left the other side.
Yeah.
How did you get started?
Is it
from the experience of talking with these farmers?
It was a good accident.
Yeah.
It was a good accident because there were gaps that existed with the farmers I was working with.
Mm.
Because, you know, when I come to you and sell to you a service, a product that is not one time, you have to follow up.
Mm.
Has equipment been delivered on time?
Mm.
Has it been installed? Mm. Has it been serviced and all the other things? Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, so there was some gaps that we are not really filled, and that's how, that's how it ended up. And we're interacting with the farmers every day. You see their problems. That said, I think that we can do better.
So you saw a solution in their common problems.
Yes.
And that's how you registered Vikale.
That's how we ended up.
How do you get the... So what does Vikale do for someone who is listening and, you know, maybe they're a farmer or they want to go into farming? What is the value add? What problem are you solving for these people?
We are solving cost of production.
Cost of production.
Cost of production is high.
Yeah.
And this is due to the high inefficiencies that come with limited farming.
Yeah.
You lose a lot of money through wastages.
Yeah.
Feed wastages.
Mm-hmm.
Thirds.
Mm.
Don't have diseases.
Mm.
You know. So, mechanization at a greater degree is sort of some of the problems.
Mm.
You know, helping you to prevent disease at a certain degree.
Mm.
Better accountability, for example, from the flock you have.
Mm.
you know, works are easier done.
Mm.
You have fewer people that work.
You spend a little on HR issues, so to speak.
Yes.
Because the systems are taking over.
Yes.
The mechanization is taking over.
Correct. In some areas.
Right. And it's more efficient and so on.
Yes. So, what we are in the business of building modern commercial poultry farms.
Modern commercial poultry farms.
Poultry farms.
Not when you say commercial, what size are you talking about?
Well, in
because
the moment,
this is a guy who can say, I have 100 birds. Will mechanization help that guy?
100 would more or less be like a hobby, so to say, as the industry has evolved. Commercial is, if you'd put a number to it, would be 5,000.
5,000 and above,
And more because.
Yeah. So a guy with 5,000 birds would benefit from your services.
Would, yes.
Of mechanization. How would you mechanize for them? What aspects of mechanization will they benefit from?
Aspects of mechanization is feeding.
Feeding,
manure.
Yeah.
Management, flock management.
Yeah.
For those who are layers.
Yeah.
Egg collection.
Egg
for
collection,
example.
Yeah.
Better results generally also.
Yeah. There's no processing. It's just mechanization, the operations.
And also processing.
Okay. What do you process?
It's at the level at which the industry is, for example, there's so much that can be done. For example, the eggs, they can be turned into liquid, they can be turned into powder.
Mm.
The need is not yet there because we do not yet have the surplus that would necessitate. Because why do you process? You process because you want to prevent eggs from going bad.
Exactly.
And you want to keep them longer.
Yeah.
Of course, for broilers, pretty much it's easy because you have to slaughter.
Yeah.
So we also into slaughtering equipment.
Yeah.
You refrigerate.
Yeah.
And then package and put into the market. Yes.
Yeah. Whoa. So a farmer with 5,000 birds who is having a problem with feeding daily, you know, I have to employ X number of people to feed.
So many people.
I have to employ the same guys to collect the eggs, or collect the manure, to clean, to sanitize, to vaccinate, and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So a guy like that comes to Vikale,
and
basically what you do, you reduce the operation cost. Of course, they're going to incur a one-time cost of setting up the systems.
Correct.
But in the long term, they have reduced their daily operation costs.
Tremendously.
A big percentage.
Yes.
And their work is now mechanized. They can even feel like they want to add more birds and stuff like that without necessarily hiring someone else to
because
do it.
Imagine in the traditional system, with 5,000, you'll have about a minimum of 5-6 people.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Also for 10, you would have 10-12 people.
Yeah.
In both ways, you have 2-3 people really
to
man this system because, you
and
know.
Every time, one of the things that I see when people are employing others to work in poultry, there's the idea of infections. People can come with their boots and so on, infections. Also, there's the idea of security.
Biosecurity.
Yeah.
And security itself, actually.
That's right. You also do security itself.
No, because you see, you must appreciate we are the biggest problems to the flocks.
Yeah.
In so many ways.
Exactly. The humans.
The humans.
Yes.
First, we are the biggest carriers of diseases.
Yes.
To these birds.
Yeah.
Secondly, the more people you have, the more problems you have on the farm because the levels of conniving are higher. Areas of accountability are few less.
Yeah.
It's, you know, because if people are accountable for a certain number or for certain areas, it's hard for them to allow those areas to go into menace.
Yeah.
You know, let's say you have a farm of 30,000 birds.
Mm.
You literally have not less than 30 people on the farm.
Mm.
You know.
Mm.
On the other hand, you end up having less than 10.
Mm. Mm.
So manning all the other 30
and
having a certain system in place for them to follow becomes hard.
Mm.
Five guys sit down and maybe able to have the trades go through.
Mm.
Not that the few cannot do, it's easier to manage.
Mm.
One of the problems you have as a farmer is that because most of the tasks are learned manually, for example, putting in water in the houses done manually, you find it extremely hard to fire this guy if he messes up.
Mm.
if your bus does not depend on this guy to have water 24/7,
mm.
if he messes up one time, you warn him, second time, you chase him out of your farm and you tell him, I don't want to see you near my farm. And that's it. You know, but you want to reduce the reliance on these people. And also biosecurity wise, what you want to do is to reduce the number of people, but also frequency. For example, water. The bus do not want to take that water. And what happens is that if you are doing it manually, the birds that in the water very quickly. And they're like humans. Bats are like humans. When anyone gets dirty, they don't drink it. So you have to make sure you keep it clean. So they have to change it every other time. That means that the frequency frequency of the human contacting the birds is quite much. Where it's automated, because by gravity you have a nipple, water goes through 24/7. You know, anytime the birds want to drink it. You know. So when you reduce the frequency, it also helps to make sure that it's easier to manage the fewer people you have. When you put, let's say, a disinfection point for them to go through, they can do it. You know, but if someone has to go there 7 times a day into the poultry house,
it's
can do it first time, second time. We are all humans. Like, whatever.
Let me skip one time. The consistency is not as guaranteed not as a mechanized.
Correct.
So, have you seen guys taking up this, our own poultry farmers? Have they, like, come on board?
Yes. I can tell you yes. Even when now that the biggest poultry farms are owned by foreigners, Ugandans are taking it on. They are embracing it.
Are they mechanizing?
Yes, they are.
They're telling you it's working for them.
Certainly, yes, it is. It's actually working out. Of course, there are still huge gaps. In the business, for example, because according to the Uganda Investment Authority, we have projections to fill. For example, by 2025, we have, as Uganda, we have an opportunity to produce 57,000 tons, metric tons.
Wow.
Of chicken that can be supplied to the region.
And
that translates to about $235 million. You know, that is between now and 2025. Of course, also there's an opportunity for day-old chicks. What happens now, we have producers here who do that. But the market is growing. So you find now that most of the people are buying from Kenchik, that is from Kenya. Others are buying from Netherlands as well. So there's an opportunity for us to set up more here that have the capacity to serve the market. So there's a gap of about 41 million day-old chicks that is also valued at about $28 million. There's an opportunity also with the eggs that can be supplied. There's an opportunity for us to set up large-scale farms to be able to produce 291 million eggs. You know, and that is $26.6 million. So, a lot of Ugandans, of course, have engaged, but they have not been able to get to the scale. Of course, challenges, they will tell you in terms of... in terms of capital, I'll tell you. But I'm in the industry, and I can see that it is because the attitude towards the industry. Not so many people know how well it's doing. Not so many people possibly understand the returns. That because I can tell you for sure that the biggest buildings in town are owned by Ugandans. Ask yourself why. So sometimes it could not be the problem that it's actually not money. It could be that for them it is a very high risk venture that they wouldn't want to undertake.
I would rather build a building than...
Yes, because, you know. But this is also where us as Vikale, we have to get involved and say, how do we help? How do we bridge the gap? How do we make sure that we are able to close in on these gaps? Because because people have the money anyway. You know. Maybe you would want to invest if there's an insurance body on board. Every time you talk about chicken with somebody, they imagine those chicken they grew up seeing that are scratching in the back. The misconception is that birds die. Yes, they die, but with mechanization, you know, diseases come also. But highly easily and easily manageable. You know, just like any other business. You know, but there is a need because population is also growing quite fast. So we have to match to be able to match up production with the growing demand, you know. And there's a need for us to make the egg the most, because the egg is one of the most nutritious foods you have.
Yeah.
It should be the most single, cheapest source of protein
going
forward.
Yeah.
I think that the egg is very important in fighting hunger.
Yeah.
You know, nutrition among children. So it is a very, very important area that we need to invest in.
Yeah.
There's something that we're doing, we think about doing as we call it now, where I would want to involve a lot of people, maybe like you.
Mm-hmm.
You would have your money,
you
know, but possibly you do not want to get involved in the in the money you are. You know, you don't want to get involved in the theft. How are you going to access the best vets in the business? How are you going to access the other people? So we are trying to think out a way how we can involve more people in the business without necessarily tiring them to be able to supervise. You know, you have your money, 100 million, 20 million. So we are looking for ways of how we can integrate that and have more people involved. This is something that we wanted to work on this year and maybe introduce it to the public. Because we see the need.
Yeah.
We see the need. I can tell you when I'm having a conversation with the big boys, the big boys, those who are the big in the business, they'll tell you that the demand is too big for them to satisfy. On the other hand, on a good day when you're speaking with a client who wants to join, they can ask you 10 times in a space of 2 hours for you to assure them of market. This is the reason we just had a company called Eggman. To be able to sell the eggs that we produce from these farms where we work. You know, because you, if you want to invest in the business, you don't want to tie yourself with the market. So it is in there to bridge this gap. If you come and set up, we are able to take on the eggs and supply them directly. Because also, on the other hand, we see a gap in the supply chain for the eggs. By the time the eggs get to you, they have been moving around quite a lot. You know, so we think that we need to shorten
the chain.
The chain. Why? Because eggs don't have a very long shelf life.
Yeah.
It is interesting when you tell people that eggs expire and they're like, 3 weeks the eggs have almost expired. So what you are doing with the Eggman is to do farm to fork.
Yeah.
That the eggs get to your table when they were laid yesterday or the other day. So that you can actually eat a fresh egg. You know, as opposed to them going through, by the time they get to you, they have 2 days to go. Sometimes when you buy a tray that is spoiled, you can't return it nowhere. Yeah, so this is what we want. That's what we're doing with the Eggman now. We're in the process already to see that we make it more convenient. We've been in the business slowly, doing some small research and also, what do they call it? Sort of trying it out. And we noticed already that we need to work on payment, so we are at the moment working on easing payment by getting Momo Pay, so that is, we make it convenient for people to pay, and also getting the eggs to these people. And already we have packages we've come up with to make sure that we are able to, you don't run out of eggs, you know, at your home, and if we have fresh eggs, safe.
So this passion of yours began when you started interfacing with with farmers.
Correct.
And you saw their problems. And you had an idea of how those problems can be solved.
Correct. And I saw the gap in the market that was there and also still exists in the
market. It still exists in the
still
market.
Exists in the market.
So Vikale is purely for poultry.
Poultry is quite big. It goes into other sectors, like maize, for example. So we also sell maize silos, grain silos as well. We've got into rabbit as well. And also another aspect for poultry is milling. So we also into feed mills as well. So we've also been having discussions with companies, because we work with a number of companies from Italy. That manufacture different equipment. We work with about 5-6. So we've also been in discussion with another company that produces equipment for cows. Because a lot of people have been asking, but also,
Because guys who are into farming, of course, when they see you, you have a solution for one aspect of the farming, they might be thinking you are the main guy to give a solution for this other ones.
The most important thing for us is to find reliable partners, because one of the things we've noticed in the business is service. This equipment has to be serviced. You have to work with a partner who's willing to be there for the customer. You have to work with someone who responds even after sale is concluded, because if there's a breakdown or something happens. For example, at the moment, all our suppliers are able to replace any part for free within a year. Mm. That is if we verify it has not been...
It's not been spoiled. Tampered with intentionally.
That's true, yes.
Where do your suppliers come from?
Italy.
For the most part, they're coming from Italy.
Italy.
I was under the impression they're from Italians. Germany.
No, they are Italians. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So most of the... All of the mechanization is imported.
Is imported.
Do you have any issues bringing the machines and stuff?
Not yet. The government at the moment is very good to us.
Yeah.
In the drive to see that we mechanize.
Nice.
For the same reason,
yeah.
All agricultural equipment is exempted.
That is absolutely beautiful.
Yes. I don't know how long that will go, but this has been going on
yeah.
as far as I've been in the business. And you just have to, please, you know, be sure.
Yeah.
I mean, verify to you already. And tell them, guys, this is going to a farm.
Yeah.
And it's going to be used to for the final consumer.
Yeah.
You know, so otherwise, you are would be charging us if we are going to bring them here and we stock.
Mm.
You know, they'll charge us 18% VAT and 6% withholding. But this we definitely don't have reasons to do. Why? Because all the products we do are customized.
Mm.
We diagonize every customer differently, depending on their problems.
Before you can bring in equipment.
Yes.
It's not like Vikale has a store of equipment and then when you go out there, you get a farmer who wants, you just go and install.
No, not really, because...
For the most part, you have to customize.
What we only keep is for spare parts.
Yeah.
It is the most important time for that.
Yeah.
When something breaks down, we are able to respond in the shortest time possible.
Yeah, of course.
So the equipment is quite huge, depending on the project.
Yeah.
So sometimes you do not have need to store.
Yeah.
So we have storage, but it is generally for the spare parts.
Yeah.
Really.
Awesome stuff. Yeah. Awesome stuff. Yeah. Man, yeah. I've learned quite a bit from you and from your story.
Mm-hmm.
I could easily say that I don't see you changing and doing anything else in life. Even if you do other things, this becomes the core. I don't know. Am I right?
For some reason, yes.
This is the core.
Eggs and poultry now, they're part of me. Because for me, looks like eggs can solve a lot of problems that most we have.
Yeah.
In terms of income as well.
Now, let me ask you.
Yeah.
Are you afraid of competition?
Competition?
Mm.
No, I'm not afraid of competition.
Is there a competition as we speak?
Yes,
today?
There is. The guys that I used to work with are still here in the market.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they're still in the market.
Are they doing exactly what you're doing?
No, no.
It looks like what you're doing is you've gone really deeper into the problem than them. Them, it was just selling stuff?
They sell stuff, yeah. So we want to have a bigger impact.
Yeah.
We want to put a block
on
the poultry business
in
this country, because you also must understand that Uganda has a competitive advantage over its neighbors when it comes to the production of eggs.
Uh-huh.
The cost is extremely so low that if you are in Kenya, you'd rather come and pick eggs in Uganda and sell them the other side, as opposed to setting up.
Yeah.
That is why the biggest poultry farms in East Africa here.
Yeah.
The biggest layer farm is here.
Yeah.
You know.
Wow.
The biggest layer farm is
in Uganda.
Yes.
Awesome stuff.
So, and that is because of the natural given gifts like the climate, soil.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
we have to take advantage of
as
a country to produce.
Yeah.
So this, apart from tourism, I think that poultry is one of the areas that we can be able to maximize on in terms of income.
Yeah.
In terms of income, yes.
Let me ask you a question. The kind of birds that you do, of course, this chicken, these are the kind of birds. What do they call? What do they call them?
The crayers?
Yeah. No. No, they make a lot of noise, but they're okay. In my village, I see them put together with chicken, but they're not necessarily chicken.
Okay.
What are they called? Guinea.
Guinea fowls.
Yeah. Do we?
It's also poultry, actually.
It's also poultry.
Yeah.
So it's part of the.
Yes, if somebody comes and they want to put up a farm.
Yeah.
A guinea fowl farm. We are there.
Yeah.
If you want to put up a quail farm. We are here.
Yeah.
So
quail.
Turkeys, yes. So it's basically poultry is quite big.
Do people do quail farming here?
I think some people are doing it.
Okay.
They are doing it on a small scale. Really.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Some people are doing it. And you can find some eggs in the supermarket for quails as well.
Yeah.
But also, as a business, I've noticed that we can also be able to seek for better markets and produce some of these things. Here. It is actually very possible because we may not have a market to eat it up, but we can be able to find better markets where we can export. The challenge, why we also think that as Vikale we need to get involved, is that the export market heavily relies on standards.
You're right.
Eggman.
Yeah.
With Eggman, we got an interest from somebody who says they want us to supply them 27,600 trays a week. That is a 40-foot container.
Yeah.
Now, it's a challenge because someone will tell you they need the same size of eggs.
Whoa.
And those are 881,000 eggs. So, all those eggs must be the same.
Same size.
Yeah, so we have to figure out how do we standardize. Because some of the requirements are ahead of us. Mm. Because in a market like this, what is the most important thing to do is an egg. Mm. An egg is an egg.
Yeah, we don't care the size.
Yes, we have not yet started grading.
Yeah.
Because with grading, you can say these are small, these are medium, these are large.
Yeah.
And somebody who wants eggs in a country somewhere, you tell you guys need 40 feet per week.
Yeah,
I need all the eggs the same size.
Yeah,
there are no jokes about this.
Yeah,
so as Ugandans who are in the business, we have to, of course, figure out how do we get ahead? How do we think ahead? How do we, because this is a business we're doing, that even if someone's starting out with 10,000, we plan a farm and design it in a way that it can be expandable to accommodate some of these features. In the future, if you need to start upgrading, in the future, if you need to do, you know, all the other things, because this is where the market is heading, you know. Definitely, so as Ugandans, we eat very few eggs, yes.
Yeah.
We have to grow the demand as well.
Yeah.
A lot of misconceptions are thrown around eggs as being bad, with cholesterol and all. Most of them are just misconceptions.
Yeah.
But also we have a great opportunity to export eggs because of our cost.
Yeah.
What is interesting that even with our predominantly high cost of production, you find that the eggs are cheaper. For example, than neighbors like Kenya. Why? Because here, maize, for example, maize is the biggest ingredient
in the feed. Yeah. And it's cheap.
Cheap, why? Because not so many Ugandans eat ugali.
Of course.
In Kenya, ugali is a staple.
Yeah, yeah.
And when Ugandans are eating ugali, they don't eat it whole.
Yeah, they eat the white thing. No wonder it's called posho.
Posho.
It's not ugali, really.
I tell you, I love Kenyan ugali.
Any
day. I don't know, I love it. Yeah. But so what happened is that, you know, they eat it differently. You have a variety of foods in Uganda that people feel like the unfair if you give them posho.
Yeah.
First of all, they've eaten through school, so most of them don't have nothing to do with posho.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, and also given that more than about 49% of the land here is arable, and also you can grow maize here in Uganda more than twice a year without irrigation. This speaks volumes. You know, it's another area that we have to explore as well. You know, so this certainly makes it a little bit cheaper. You know, that is why you would find that some people can be adamant to mechanize or modernize. You know, because even then they are still making their small margin. They don't really mind as much. But certainly the conversation is changing, and the industry is growing, bent towards eliminating those that are inefficient.
Yeah.
So the point for any Ugandan that wants to join the poultry industry and wants to stay in for the overall in a long time, one of the things they need to watch out for, think about, is how do we watch the cost of production.
Right.
Because it is the biggest, most important determinant that is going to play out in, you know, in the coming years.
If you're going to stay in the game, not continue doing what you've always been doing.
Also, as Vikale, we are very much interested in working with those who are looking to be in the game longer.
Yeah.
You know, not those who are not very sure.
Say, just trying a side hustle or something of that nature.
So we want to work with those that are going to be in the business longer because they certainly will be able to benefit the business more.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I've had a good discussion with you, Vikale, and I'm so happy about what you're doing. One of the things I'm interested on this podcast, Life Signatures, is what people are doing and they're passionate about and what impact and transformation it's bringing. So for you, it's bringing a big transformation in the sector in the poultry sector. Correct. In agriculture.
In agriculture, yes.
And that's what we need. In fact, it's something that is going to grow by leaps and bounds in the coming years.
That's true.
I think this is going to be the way to go for anyone who wants to remain relevant in the poultry farming business. Otherwise, they will not stay in there. So thank you so much for the work you're doing. I'm sure that at another point in time we'll come and have another discussion.
That's true.
Because there are very many things that we've not talked about.
Thank you for listening.
I'm glad you're doing this. And so, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in and listening.
On iTunes, Stitcher, or visit our website at lifesignatures.livesyn.com. Life Signatures Radio, fresh, clean, and inspiring.